Yeah, they're doing a great job at the defensive end. It's, I think, part of the tradition of their program. They've taken great pride in building a great defensive foundation. What makes them so difficult is they play a lot of pressure defense at the full court level, and then they put a lot of pressure on you to finish at the rim with the great shot blockers. So the two most important things are being able to handle the full court pressure and then being able to get baskets inside the paint and not have them contest your shot and block your shot and make it really, really difficult for you to finish around the rim.
Do you think they've been able to use this preseason, you know, self-imposed ban sort of a motivation to
them? Oh, I'm sure the kids are very highly motivated to try to win the regular season, because that's the goal now. You know, it's not the ACC tournament. It's not postseason. It's not the NCAA. It's not winning a national championship. They're not going to be given that opportunity. But they are able to compete for the regular season title, and they've been playing like it. They've been playing great defense. They've really a very, very talented team. Those two fifth-year seniors, Damian Lee and Trey Lewis, are two fifth-year seniors and they're two leading scorers. But they've got a lot of young talent. Chinanu Onowaku, I think, is an NBA player. I've heard talk that he's going to go after this year, and he's likely to be a first-round draft pick. Have a lot of other terrific athletes so that they can rotate different guys. Quentin Snyder is having a great season at the point. They're a handful for anybody.
Jim, I wanted to ask you something about roster building. Obviously, the two benefits of having transfers is, one, the guys you brought in have been really good players for the most part. Second thing is it's given you an older team, obviously, which serves as an advantage. Does that make you want to do more of that, or do you look at transfers as only if we don't have enough incoming freshmen with our scholarships?
Well, I think there needs to be a balance on your roster of returning players, veteran players, with new talent coming in from the high school ranks. And if you look at our team right now, we have four seniors, two juniors, two sophomores, and two freshmen. So we're more of a senior-dominated team. We'll have seven players returning, because we have six returning players plus a transfer sitting out. So that's seven guys. But our size leaves. Tanya and Yvonne, we're not very big. We're really not very big this year when you consider Tanya's really the only center on the team. The other big guys are more power forward types or stretch fours.
So is it good then to look every year?
Oh, yeah, you should. In recruiting right now, there's so much, there's so many different levels that you can recruit. You can recruit seniors in high school. You can recruit prep school. You can recruit junior college kids. You can recruit Division I transfers who have to sit out a year. You can recruit fifth-year players who have graduated and will be immediately eligible. So you have a lot of different options. You can recruit locally, you can recruit nationally, and you can recruit internationally. And with all of those options available to you, especially when you're an international city like Miami, you want to take advantage of all those different possibilities.
Can you talk about Davon Reed, the game he had the other day, and just, you know, you think he's someone who's really going to be very important in the next couple of games going to the ACC?
Yeah, I think Davon's had a great career so far. He's had a terrific junior year. I was so impressed with the way he played against Virginia because he was so calm.
He was
very much in control. He was very focused and very confident. When he made that first shot, it actually gave me a great deal of confidence, not just that it went in, but how much control he seemed to have. He was not in a hurry. The shot clock was probably winding down, and yet he seemed like to have all the time in the world. And that's the sign of a really good player. I tell the players all the time, there's three things you got to try to control: The first is yourself. The second is the guy guarding you. And the third is the other eight players around you. And the first is you've got to be mentally in control and emotionally in control of yourself. Physically, you got to be on balance. You got to be able to execute whatever you're doing, dribbling, passing, shooting. You got to be in control of the situation, know what the score is, know what the time is. And then you add to that, okay, I got to be in control of my defender. What does that mean? Well, I'm going to drive to the basket, and he's in my way. I got to maneuver him so he's no longer in my way. And the last part is trying to control the other eight guys. I thought Tanya Jakiri did about as good a job as you can do when we threw the ball into him and he was being trapped. So he was in control of himself. He knew where his defender was. He was in control of his defender, but then they double-teamed with, with a second defender, and he didn't rush the pass. He calmly found the open man, a lot of times for an assist, but even if it's not for an assist, it's to get the ball out of trouble. And those eight guys, our team responded very well to his passing, and the Virginia defense had to react to his passing. So he was very much in control of all three things. And we try to get all our players to do that all the time. And it is difficult.
Is a lot of that, though, it seems the veteran nature of the team really, in those moments where younger guys might just panic or lose the ball, the fact that you have so, almost every opposing coach has come in and mentioned the veteran nature of your team and how important it is to your success.
Well, I think the greatest teacher is experience. And that's for all of us. You know, when you're growing up and you don't have all the skills you have now, you learned through experience. And there's no greater teacher than doing. And these guys have been doing it now for a long time.
Do you feel pretty good with Davon going up to the free throw line there?
Oh, yeah. You know, one of the things you see is he wanted to be on the foul line. How do you know that? Because when the Jaquan took the ball out of bounds, he immediately ran and said, give me the ball. So when they fouled him, he was looking forward to being at the foul line. That's what you want. That's the attitude you want.
Do you think he's maybe a little bit, Davon, just underrated maybe because there's so much focus put on Sheldon and Angel and even Jaquan?
Well, he's not underrated on our team, but he might be underrated by you guys, by the media. I doubt he's underrated by our opponents. Because they watch tapes and they see how hard and how well he plays. Now, he may not get the recognition some guys get, but that's because you only have room for how many guys are going to get a lot of attention. Angel and Sheldon and maybe even Tanya get the most attention. Just like if you look at a Duke team, you see Grayson Allen and Brandon Ingram are getting a majority of their attention. Bryce Johnson, Marcus Paige for North Carolina. Everybody's got their two leading scorers. Damian Lee, Trey Lewis are getting a lot of attention. Chinanu Onowaku. But it's hard for everybody on your team to get the recognition that they truly deserve.
And I know it was obviously more than a year ago, but what do you think he took from that experience of being sidelined with the
injury? Oh, I thought last year he learned how much hard work pays off because no one expected him to be back in December. I know I didn't. I thought there was a very good chance we were going to have to redshirt him last year, that he'd come back in mid to late January, and that was going to be too late to really make the year worthwhile. But his rehab was absolutely fantastic, and don't know if we've ever had a player who was more diligent and determined to come back. And then he was so focused. When you work that hard, you want it to pay off. And it paid off for a huge sophomore year after missing the first eight games.
Virginia got six teams within two games of each other for the ACC regular season title. Is that sort of how you envisioned it at the start of the year? I mean, it's such a talented division at the top.
Okay, Matt, start at the beginning of that question again, if you would.
Six teams, including yourself. Oh,
two
games
yeah,
the
yeah.
Top of the standings. Not just like two, not like Duke, North Carolina, and everyone else, you know. I mean, it's a lot of teams. Is that how you envision it at the end of this year when you first looked at all the talent?
I thought there was a possibility we'd have 10. because that's how many talented teams I saw: size, speed, quickness, skill, experience. You look at some of the teams that are not what was in your top six, and you look at their roster and you think, well, they could have easily been in the top five or six. And we've been very fortunate. We've won a lot of close games this year, and we've been a team that shoots very good free throws, which is an important part of end-of-game situations. We've improved our defense, and that has allowed us to be, in the end, a very good team to finish. The only area that we continue to work on that has been a source of concern is rebounding, an area that we thought we were going to be very, very strong in that we've been inconsistent in. And to end this season, we know we need to be better.
Yeah, that we talk about that with Louisville too. I think they're out rebounding opponents by 8 or 9 a game.
Yeah, killing people. They are so athletic and long and big, and they lose one of their guys, and then someone else just steps in and blocks 3 shots and gets 5 rebounds.
What's your relationship with Coach Pitino? You know, you play against a lot of big time coaches. What's your background with him?
I was a senior at Providence College when I believe he was a sophomore at University of Massachusetts. So I've known of him actually more when he started coaching at Five Star, which is a basketball camp run by Howard Garfinkel. And he was the young protege and ended up being a head coach at like the age of, I don't know, 23 or 4 at the University of Hawaii. He then had several coaching stops, but ended up the head coach at my alma mater, a job that I interviewed for, that he ended up getting the job. And he did a fantastic job during his, I believe, 4 seasons there, taking Providence College to the Final Four in 1987. His assistant, Ralph Willett, is a very good friend of mine and someone I've stayed in touch with over the years, who I invited over to actually help our team a few years back when we needed to put in a zone defense and I had no idea what we were going to do. And Ralph has been a terrific head coach at Western Kentucky, Pittsburgh, and Holy Cross. And he was a tremendous high school coach at St. Dominic's of Oyster Bay on Long Island. And I recruited some of his players way back when. So my familiarity with Coach Pitino, Coach Willard, their style of play, they've done a great job.
Coach, what are your thoughts on Sheldon's play these last 2-3 games?
Well, I think he's been not 100%. I think the ankle has bothered him. I think he's still been efficient. He just hasn't scored big. He's been in double figures, 10, 11. And for us, he needs to get 20 now. He really does, because he has that capability. And we're going to need that ability, because these teams that we're playing are so good defensively. You know, Virginia was so good defensively. Thank goodness Davon was able to step up and score in the 20s. All right, but we're going to need someone to do that on Saturday and then again on Wednesday and Saturday.
I'm just curious, with Jaquan back, how's he look to you?
I don't think he's been himself either. He went through a very, very rough week. And he missed the game against Virginia Tech at home. He had a rough day against North Carolina. We all did. And he hurt his knee. He didn't practice on Sunday. He was limping all day Monday. And then all of a sudden, like a miracle, he was playing Monday night. And he was very effective driving to the basket. And that's been a real asset to our offense, to have a guy who can get inside the defense and finish at the rim over big defenders like Louisville has.
I'm just curious, if you've talked to Coach Conkle and Huger throughout
Yeah, we communicate by text and phone calls all the time, and it's fun for me to listen to them complain about how hard head coaching is.
How it seems like your new stuff, though, I mean, these are guys you had forever, and these new guys have stepped into those roles.
Yeah. I've got a great, great staff. Yeah, you know, Coach Caputo is the associate head coach now, but he's been with me forever. He's due to be a head coach. He's really more than ready to step in and take over his own program, and it would be very smart of an athletic director looking to bring in a young guy like him. He's really skilled in every aspect of coaching, recruiting, networking, public relations, developing relationships with people from all walks of life. And then James Johnson worked for me at George Mason, so it was a good transition for him. Jamal Brunt has been a great asset. He and his wife Erica and their daughter Peyton are just a wonderful family and fit in with our philosophy for family first. And he's a very knowledgeable basketball coach, and he's going to be a head coach very, very soon. He's interviewed for head coaching jobs, and I hope that our success this year will help create opportunities for my staff. Adam Fisher, I'm not expecting to lose him because he's just starting. This is his first year, but he has taken on a major role as our scout team coordinator, and he's finding out how hard a job that is to study every opponent and watch every game and bring to me a concise message as to how we need to prepare for this particular opponent. And he's done a great job with that.
What do you have to say about Malcolm Brogdon?
You know, we knew and have played against Malcolm, so we knew he's a great player. He's an NBA draft pick. He might not be drafted as high because, unfortunately, the NBA doesn't value experience. They value youth over experience. But that guy's going to be in the NBA for the next 10, 12 years. And he is very, very capable of going in and helping an NBA team today.
Jim, in the case of your current transfers, was it a case of them reaching out to you initially with Kamari, Sheldon, Angel? Did you reach out to them? Do you remember how that...
Well, you don't reach out to them until they get a release from their school. But in Angel Rodriguez's case, his high school coach is a very close friend of our programs, and he reached out to us letting us know that Angel was about to ask for a release and if we had interest in him to let him know. And when I spoke to Angel for the first time, he just told me he wanted to come to Miami, wanted to get back closer to home, wanted to be near his mom and friends in Miami. And that worked very, very quickly. In Sheldon McClellan's case, Sheldon was very familiar with Angel, and a close friend of ours in Houston, where Sheldon is from, John Lucas, who played at Maryland, was the first player chosen in the 76 draft. John Lucas has been a friend of mine since 1972, where he was a counselor at the Davidson basketball camp, and I was the coordinator for the camp. And so John recommended Miami. We were one of the three or four schools Sheldon visited, but Angel Rodriguez, and he recruited him along with Coach Caputo, and were able to get Sheldon to come here. And then Kamari Murphy, we recruited him out of IMG Academy in Sarasota. He was very, very familiar with us and probably would have chosen us the first time had we not been under NCAA investigation. So he contacted us the moment he decided to leave Oklahoma State.
It was Art Alvarez with Angel. That was the coach, Art Alvarez?
No, Shaky Rodriguez, his high school coach at Dr. Krop.
Okay. The amount that you're spending on international recruiting, are there more resources being devoted to that? I know you're looking everywhere for players.
I would say we have limited resources and we budget wisely. Oh, yeah, I think you have to give my staff a little bit of credit of figuring out where the money should be spent and how much should be spent and budgeting wisely so that we're being the most frugal basketball program in the ACC.
Has the focus been Europe, Australia, South America?
All of the above.
Okay. And have you traveled to any of those places looking at players, or is that not in the budget?
It's not in the budget for me, but my staff has been to Europe and has been to Australia. I went to Canada, so that's international. I went for a day. Actually, no, I went for several days. I went in July and I went in September.
In terms of the schedule this week, kind of what's the plan? You've got a little bit of breathing room.
We took yesterday off. Today is still a recovery day because we got so many beat up guys. Angel is exhausted. Tanya, he's worn out. Sheldon's ankle and everybody else is beat up pretty good. So today is only going to be a team meeting and a mental preparation. We're going to show them some things on tape. And then tomorrow we will get back at it and get ready for Louisville.
Such a quick announcement. Tanya has been named one of 11 college players for the Eddie Sutton Award, which is the award singled out a player who exhibits the traits of tenacity and unselfishness.
Oh, man, I hope he wins that. He would deserve it. He'd be a... Who are the other candidates?
Semifinalists, Ryan Archer.
Oh, yeah.
From Villanova.
Zach
August. Michael Carrera, South Carolina. Matt Costello, Michigan State. Roosevelt Jones, Butler. Frank Mason, the third, Kansas. Marshall Plumlee, Duke.
Oh.
Lewis, Kentucky. Justin Sears, Yale. And Thomas Walker, Stephen Boston.
Good company.
Can you talk about his journey, kind of, you know, from where he started, freshman year,
After the game yesterday, it is really hard to put a number on how much he impacts the game. They showed a number on TV. He's a plus 52 when he's on the court, and we're a minus 12 when he's off. That's obviously a huge number, but it's even greater than that. For example, the rebound he got where he and Anthony Gill, who's a great player, going to be in the NBA as well, they were fighting for a rebound, and he jerked it out of his hand to control the board. That was so impressive. He could not have done that as a freshman. He just wasn't experienced enough. He wasn't strong enough. He wasn't competitive enough in that area of rebounding. Now he makes it his mission to control the backboards. But something that went unnoticed, that you wouldn't have noticed, but that my staff, we talk about Coach Fisher's job as the scout team coordinator. There's a play in basketball that we refer to as close the door. Some teams we call it close the gate, the close the window, where a player runs through an opening and then two players close off that opening so the defender can't get through. Well, they ran it against us very late in the game to get Malcolm Brogdon a shot. And instead of Malcolm being able to get through the door so they can close it, Tanya closed the door for him. He went in the way of the path that Malcolm would have gone through, and that prevented a three-point basket. Those are the things you can't measure. There was a play earlier in the game where a guy was going to get a layup, and Tanya left his man out at the top of the key, ran to the basket, prevented the shot. The ball got skipped out, and then he was out there guarding the three-point shot, and the guy didn't shoot it. So he prevented a two-point basket, then he prevented a three-point basket. If he's not the ACC Player of the Year, I don't know who is Defensive Player of the Year. I don't know where we would even be without it. We certainly wouldn't be one of those six teams vying for the regular season title. We would be at the bottom of this league. And his defense has allowed us to be one of the better defensive teams in the conference. We're up there with the Virginias, the Louisvilles. Our KenPom numbers are very, very solid. I don't know where we are today, but we're competitive. And we wouldn't be without him.
And how much upside is there still, do you think? I mean, on the offensive side or just in general, he's still fairly new.
If I were an NBA team and I had the foresight to understand that even though this guy is 22 years old, He has the experience of an 18-year-old. He's only played the game for a short while. Most kids start playing when they're 7, 8 years old. My grandson started playing when he was 3. So when my grandson gets to be 18, he's going to have 15 years of basketball skills and development. Tanya's not going to be there until he's 30. So if some NBA team had the foresight to say, let's take him and let's put an individual personal instructor on skill development and footwork, I think he's done a good job of learning, but we couldn't teach him enough. We don't have enough hours. Now, we're limited, 20 hours during the season and 8 hours during the offseason. Those 8 hours, we're only given 2 on the court. That's like, you know what that's like? It's like telling a student you can only study 2 hours in a week for your schoolwork, and you got how many courses? You know, you have 5 classes you're taking, but you can only study for 2 hours. My players would like that if that were the NCAA rule. You can play basketball as much as you want, but you can only study for 2 hours. Oh, my God. I'm so sad. I want to be an A student. I can only do 2 hours. But the reverse is true. You can't become a great skilled player with 2 hours of instruction in a week. You really need hours and hours on the court. If we played a video of Steph Curry and then also J.J. Redick. And J.J. Redick was talking about Steve Nash and how much time he devoted during the offseason. And he basically said it's like a job, 8 hours a day. 8 hours a day they're putting in, not 8 hours a week and 2 hours of that week to be on skills. And if you want to be a professional athlete, when my sons were young, I said to them, if you want to play in high school, put in an hour or two every day. If you want to be a Division I player, you got to put in 3 hours a day. If you want to be a pro, you got to put in 5 hours a day.
Jim, it's easy to find plus minus for NBA, but it's very difficult in your sport. Do you know off the top of your head whether Tanya is your leader in plus minus?
No, he's not in our leader in plus minus. Amy, you do that, right? Do you have that right there? Oh, you don't have the email there. Yeah, no, I don't believe he's the leader in plus minus. But you have to understand how to read plus minus. Because if I leave him in the game with guys who are struggling, he gets the minus. Right? If I only left him in there with the starters, then his plus minus would be a lot higher. They determined before the game to 4 or 5 trap him. I think basically from having scouted us in the previous games and how important a part he has become of our offense. And I thought our guys did a great job of sharing the ball and putting the ball in his hands in the low post. He touched it in the high post, then touched it in the low post on a lot of possessions. And our goal of 240 passes in the game, we blew that away. I think with 298 against Virginia. I'm not sure if that's right. It was a lot. Might have been 289. Thanks, everybody. Lunchtime.